All right. Well, I want to, this is part 7 and 8 of a series entitled The Work of Preparation. And as we begin, I want to invite all that are able to join me as far as possible in prayer. My Father in heaven, I am aware in a small way of the weight of solemn responsibility that rests upon me in being your mouthpiece at this time. And Father, it is my earnest prayer that you would allow me to get out of the way, that you would prohibit self in me from standing between you and your people. Amen. I want more than anything for the truth as it is in Jesus to come forth. And dear Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would minister to each of us through your written and inspired word, and that our thoughts and our hearts, Father, would be drawn to you, to heaven, to eternal themes. And dear God in heaven, please bless our assembly with your holy presence. Send your mighty angels to fill this room, and that your angels would dispel the darkness enemy so quickly draws about us. Loving Father, we thank you for your attendance, and we thank you for your promise that where two or more are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of them, and we thank you. Father, bless us on this, your holy Sabbath. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right. Again, this is part 7 of what is now turning into an 8-part series that I didn't intend to be. But I feel that this material is important enough and pertinent enough to include with the Work of Preparation series that we're about to send out. So as closing thoughts, I want us to consider this. The title of this is The Tree of Knowledge, Part 1 and Part 2. The Tree of Knowledge, Part 1 and Part 2. And what we're going to look at are, as I said a moment ago, are basic principles. But in the context that we're going to consider them, they're going to speak some very powerful, powerful lessons to us that I believe that we need to take to heart personally as we are fast approaching the end of all things. The focus of this series is to be prepared. How many remember what it was that John the Baptist said to the people? What was his message to the people?
Behold,
right. Behold, Lamb of God. Right, but I'm talking about the message that you and I are to bear. Prepare to meet your God. That's what Sister White says is our message. Okay? Prepare to meet your God. Also, behold your God is another of John the Baptist's statements. But in particular, realize that there's a work of preparation. Sister White will tell us that the scenes connected with the close of probation are clearly presented, but multitudes have no more understanding of them than if they had never been revealed. So what we want is we want to be prepared. Amen? We want to be prepared personally. And I want to tell you that I hate to disappoint those that are going to be coming into this presentation by some other means. I'm not here to bash the church. I'm not here to set our ministry higher by lowering your opinion of the church. And I see more and more ministries climbing into prominence because they're able to do this. They're able to air the laundry of our church. Though I know all those things, friends, if I don't have the love of Christ in my soul, if I don't possess the character of Jesus in the very near future, I am lost. And so are you. Amen. That's the focus, and that's the reason for this series. It's not to make others look bad. How many of us can point the finger? How many of us can throw the first stone? Okay? Let's pull the weeds in our own gardens right now and leave the weeds to the others for their own garden. That's my focus. Come with me, if you will, as we begin this. The title, again, is The Tree of Knowledge. So we want to go back into the Garden of Eden, in Genesis chapter 2. And let's look at verses 8 and 9. Verses 8 and 9. And we're reading about creation. At the close of creation, God is accomplishing, wrapping up this work. Verse 7, He's formed man of the dust of the ground. And then notice in verse 8 with me, it says, And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there He put the man whom He had formed. Now I want you to realize, keep in your mind that the whole Bible is couched in the context of the garden, planting and harvesting, okay? From Genesis to Revelation, Genesis, here we are. Where are we now in Genesis chapter 2? What has he planted? He's planted a garden. Well, now, what about Revelation 14? There's a thrusting into the sickle. There's a reaping. There's a harvesting, right? And what I'm saying to you is if you pay attention, the whole Bible is portraying the work of Christ in recovering man in the setting of planting and harvesting. Okay, and this is where we are. We are right here in the early spring, just before summer, where the harvest occurs. So, verse 9 says, "And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food." Notice with me, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So God makes all the trees, but what is it that he puts right in the middle, not on the edges, but right in the middle of the garden?
The tree of life.
There's two trees in particular, right? All right, what I want you to see, I'm going to tell you this and we're going to set out and prove this, but there are only two classes of people in the world today. We're going to read that in just a second. But because of that, Jesus puts two trees right there in the middle of the garden. Let's call them the tree of life and the tree of death, okay? Because that's what they are. So with that in place, let's consider this. We're going to look at the story of Eve, but before we get to the tree of death or the tree of knowledge, let's look at the tree of life and let's understand some things that may be new to us. I want to read this quote to you from Christ Object Lessons, page 283, paragraph 3. I said it to you. Now let's read it. And I want you to consider as we read this, this quote, the more I considered it after I pasted it into this document, I was overwhelmed at how profoundly solid this quote is. What it says is the greatest argument against so many pathetic arguments today in how we're to get to heaven. Let's notice it. There are only two classes in the world today. Now, I had an opportunity to sit in a church board meeting years ago in another church in another state. And the pastor's wife, when I said, as I was contending of things that our church was looking to try to do to get involved with the community, there was compromise there. And what I was identifying is that there is only two classes, and right now we are not of that class. Yes, the majority of them are going to come in and fill the ranks of where I'm standing if I'm not careful, but right now they are not. And they are the Gentile world. So she says, "I don't believe there's only two classes." I produced this quote. Okay, this is one of many that say this, but notice what else she does say. There are only two classes in the world today, and only two classes will be recognized in the judgment. Notice what they are. This is going to distill down who's going to heaven and who isn't. Those who violate God's law, and those who what?
Obey
it. So what does salvation come down to? Obedience, amen? We agree on that. Because you see, as parents, any of us that are parents, the one thing that we stress more than anything from our child, and the thing most prominent in the spirit of prophecy and child guidance, is to teach your child what?
Obedience.
Obedience. It can save their life. Years ago, my older sons, when they were younger, I was out with a friend on his boat. It was his maiden voyage with this new boat that he had bought. It wasn't brand new, it was new to him. And he didn't know that the transom in the back, the wood within the fiberglass, was totally shot. And we made our way out to this point. And I had my two sons and he had his son. And I had been training my children, listen, you do what I say when I tell you, because you never know, it may cost you your life one day. And I always emphasize that to them. So we're leaving the island, we're coming back to the marina, and I'm driving. And we're leaving the island behind, and as I'm giving it gas, you do until you start to, you want to break plane and get up on plane. And as I gave it that last little bit, we heard a loud pop. We looked around, we didn't know what it was. Moments later, as I gave it more gas, the whole transom ripped out of the back of the boat, which the transom itself was right at floor level. So that means that the motor was about to leave the boat, still running, and water rushed in across the floor of the boat. Swept past our feet, and immediately my two sons looked up at me. I said, in those front seats right there are life jackets. Get them on. I said, and I looked at the gate. I said, we're in 15 feet of water. If the boat sinks, we'll stand on top of it and wait for somebody to come get us. There's plenty of boats out here. Don't worry about it. Meanwhile, the owner's son is in a panic, and he's probably 5 years older than my boys, but he's in a panic. He's of a secular mind. And he is screaming and screaming, and he's in a condition where his dad had to step in and become forceful for a minute to tell him to be quiet. But friends, what I said all of that for was this. What Jesus is looking for is obedience. He says, if you love me, what?
Obey
me. If you love me, Peter, do you love me? Oh Lord, you know I love you. Then feed my sheep. It's about obedience, okay? So let's keep that in mind as we consider some challenges that we face. We're going to come now to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 6. In Matthew chapter 5, we're going to drop in on the Sermon on the Mount and listen to some of the things that Jesus is sharing with those that are gathered about him in his very first effort to reach out beyond the wedding and begin to minister to the people. He lays down some ground rules. I want you to consider verse 6 of chapter 5. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after what?
Righteousness.
Now, our hunger and our thirst should have the focus of obtaining righteousness. You know how our hungers can drive us to do some crazy things. Our hunger for righteousness should cause us to go over the wall for it. For they shall be filled. Now, come with me, if you will, to John chapter 6. Just wanted to see this emphasis, John chapter 6 now, and beginning in verse 51. Jesus is going to say some things that really shake up the crowd. He's going to say some things that they do not want to hear, cannot hear, and do not understand. Now, as you turn into John chapter 6, we're going to begin in verse 51. Let me make a statement here, an observation probably, and that's this, friends. Jesus had a message. He was saying something, and he was speaking in plain English, but he was wanting them to understand the spiritual application of it. Does that make sense? You understand what I'm saying? But there was a condition that arose that prohibited a large number from understanding or receiving that message. And there are those who have dropped in into this situation right here and broke these verses down and identified other people as those disciples that walked with Jesus no more over literal spiritual circumstances. But I want us to understand one thing here that I'm trying to mention now. Those who could not receive Jesus' message, what he was really trying to say, what kept them from it was they were not able to see the spiritual application of it. They could only see the literal, and we're told by inspiration it's because they had refused to see the signs that proved that Jesus was the Son of God. They had hardened their hearts to that. So when Jesus spoke spiritual words, they were not able to receive it or understand it. Okay? So here's what I'm saying in summary. We cannot say that the condition of those men was the message. That's my point. Because while some have come and camped out on those verses that were identifying how some men were seeing things literal today when they should be spiritual, and therefore they're none of God's people, that's quite an accusation to make. They themselves never saw the message that Jesus was giving, and that's what we want to look at. And he says a very powerful thing, that other party, they're not getting it either, all right? So let's be careful here in John chapter 6 to not miss the message for looking at a condition. Amen? Amen. Verse 51, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And he did this at the cross, did he not? Mm-hmm. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Now you have to understand that in the Jewish economy, Levitical law prohibited them from eating anything that had blood in it. Okay? They could not partake of food that had blood in it, much less drink your blood. What are you saying? They say to themselves. But remember, they had hardened their heart, according to the spirit of prophecy, against the teaching of Christ and the evidences that he was in fact the Son of God. So now, therefore, their minds were blinded, their eyes were closed spiritually to understanding what he was trying to teach them. Verse 52, the Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Now they are completely appalled if you follow the account in the spirit of prophecy, because this is totally against what their Levitical law taught them. But they were not seeing the spiritual. Whoso eateth my flesh, this is a promise now, and drinketh my blood, hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So what is it? How can you and I get eternal life, according to that verse?
By eating the word.
By eating his flesh and drinking his blood. Okay, not a trick question there. We want to qualify these things. Verse 55, for my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. Remember, we began in Matthew 5, blessed is he who hungers and thirsts. What we need to be doing in order to satisfy that hungering and thirst is to eat his flesh and drink his blood. Because those two will satisfy that hungering and thirsting. Amen. And the result will be what?
Amen.
His righteousness. Amen? Okay. Verse 56, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. What is that? What is it if he's dwelling in me and I'm in him? What is that? What do we call that?
Holy Spirit.
We call that being one with the Father. We call that being grafted into the true vine, right? We're drawing that living sap.
Indwelling.
Amen.
One purpose.
As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall what? Live by me. To eat his flesh and drink his blood is eternal life. All right, so let's look at this. I want to read you a quote you have before you there from the Bible Commentary, volume 5, page 1135, paragraph 8. She's going to read many of the verses that we've read and then some others, and then she's going to say something in the very end. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood, says Christ, hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. Now watch. It is the Spirit that quickeneth, or makes alive. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. Now here's the kicker. This is eating the fruit of the tree of life. Now remember where we began. In the garden there's two trees. And before we deal with the tree of knowledge, the tree of death, we're going to deal with the tree of life. And let's understand what it is to partake of the tree of life. So what is it to partake of the tree of life? What is it to eat the fruit? It's to eat of his flesh and drink of his blood.
His salvation.
Okay? Now this is really quite simple but quite profound every time we address this subject. When we walk up to the tree of life today, we do so when we go into God's Word, and we're going to look at definitions of what it is to eat his flesh and drink his blood. But we are partaking of the fruit of that tree of life.
Amen.
Okay, that's what we're being taught here. Notice John 17, verse 3. You know this when we're in John. Go to chapter 17. Again, one of those profound verses. Now, what we want when we come to the tree of life, what are we given? What is it that we're eating of again?
The flesh and the blood.
The Word of God, right? What is the Word of God? It's knowledge.
It's the written testament of Jesus Christ.
Amen? But it is knowledge.
Personally.
Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. The just shall live by their faith. How does faith come? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We need the knowledge. Amen? This is what we've been dealing with in both the Experience series and this series. The knowledge is what we need to become aware of conditions. God deals with you and I. He brings me to a passage that is speaking directly to a situation in my life. And it's through the Word of God that I receive counsel. The Spirit of God is there to impress that upon my heart and bring conviction that I need to change in that area. Isn't that how it works? We need the knowledge. Okay? So when we come to the tree of life, we want knowledge because we want to be different people, don't we? But there's the same reason that Eve went to the tree. But let's follow on. John 17:3 says this, "And this is life eternal." So John's about to, Christ is about to give us a clue clearly as to what eternal life is all about. That they might what? Know. That they might know. All right, so knowledge is what eternal life is all about. But what kind of knowledge now? Now we're going to look at two different trees. One is the knowledge of good and evil. What is the other a knowledge of? That's what we want to look at. What is this knowledge? Okay? Eternal life is about knowing the Father and Jesus Christ. Realize that now. Eternal life is about knowing the Father. Do you understand that?
Amen.
You and I must know the Father.
Amen.
In order to have eternal life. But Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right?
Exactly.
Okay, so here's my point. The knowledge of the tree of life is the fruit. We're going to see later it's also the leaves. We're going to see that it is the tree of life. Okay, so when we come to that tree, what we're wanting is knowledge, but we have a different motive for coming and gaining that knowledge. And we're going to see what that is. At least we need to. Let me just read to you. I have three quotes I want to read to you. The first one here is from Testimonies to Ministers, page 346, paragraph 1. Thousands upon thousands are in ignorance, perishing out of Christ. Yet money and time and labor are devoted to the class who are ever learning, yet never able to come to the, what kind of knowledge?
Experimental
knowledge of the truth, because why are they not able to get to this experimental knowledge? Because they will not practice the truth. Oh, wait a minute. I just wanted the knowledge. Now you're telling me I have to do something. Do you think there's a class within our church, within God's church around the world, that want the knowledge apart from obedience?
Yes.
Is that possible?
Yes.
How about this? Review and Herald, July 21st, 1891. Friends, this is more deadly than we realize. Now, yes, there is a certain personality that I know openly teaches that if you study their message, just study their message, that God is going to transform your character supernaturally just through the study. It denies obedience. It bypasses the obedience and other elements that must come with that knowledge or as a result of that knowledge. This is why it is so sinister and deadly. But let's move on. This is about practice here. So Review and Herald, July 21st, 1891, paragraph 11. All should be learners, but not ever learning and never coming to a knowledge of the truth. Be diligent students, and all the time practice what you learn. Now pause. Whatever you're learning out there today, whatever prophetic theme you're studying, whatever parallels, whatever it is that you're seeing, can you practice it in your daily walk? Huh? Now that takes a whole new meaning for the term learning. Are you learning about what bearings work best in a 67 Chevrolet front end? Well, that knowledge doesn't help me at all in my walk with God. That's an extreme exaggeration of what I'm trying to show you, but what are you learning today? So you're handling biblical themes. You're seeing parallels between this history and that history. Great. What is it doing for your walk with Jesus Christ today? How can that, what lesson is in that you can bring before yourself and consider, I need to start doing that. I need to implement that lesson into my life today.
Amen.
Because listen, we're supposed to be preparing for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We're not here to become super educated. I'll do that on the other side of Jesus' second coming. I'm going to learn all those neat and incredible facts of how God made things work. But what I need right now is the counsel of John the Baptist, and that is prepare to meet your God.
Amen.
I want to prepare a character. It's the house that's being built in Matthew chapter 7 upon that foundation, the Rock of Ages, Jesus Christ. So, this quote right here brings to mind something that so many out there need to answer for themselves. What are you learning today? What parallels, whatever it is you're learning, and I'm not knocking these things, but what I'm saying to you is they can become a distraction. Are they things that you can bring into your personal experience right now? Things that you can say, I need to be better about that. Understand, do parallels do this for you? If so, fantastic. But you've got to answer that question yourself. So my point is, and what is being said here is, be diligent students and all the time practice what you learn. So you cannot just gain knowledge, friends. What you're to do is to learn to the effect of changing who you are. If your learning is not feeding into that work, you are spinning your wheels and you'll be sitting here when Jesus leaves with the rest of them. That's the facts. This will give you an experience. Whoa, there it is. The Millerites had an experience. They had the Philadelphian experience. They had that brotherly love.
Amen.
And it wasn't born of man. It was born of Christ. It was His self-sacrificing love. As they beheld the truths that proved to them the imminent coming of Christ, as they beheld that, as that catalyst was set before them, that impetus, they went to the foot of the cross. They understood that Jesus was to be their atonement for sin. And now their focus wasn't about dates. Their focus was, am I ready to meet my Savior who has laid down His life for me and given all? What am I giving today? What are you giving today? That's our question. These are the hard questions. Knowledge doesn't come free, friends. If it does, you are lost and dead. But if you take hold of the knowledge that Christ wants to give us, oh, friends, our lives will change. That's what the Word of God is to do. The Word of God is not to tantalize our intellect. The Word of God is to show us our sin, show us our shortfalls, and yet at the same time point us to the cross where we behold our only hope of salvation, Jesus Christ, whose hand is extended to every soul right now, pleading for us to let go of the things of this world. Next and final quote before we move forward, identifying the learning, the knowledge that we have. This is taken from Review and Herald, January the 6th, 1903, paragraph 1. The Lord will work with humble men who reveal that they are ever learning, ever under the control of the Holy Spirit. Such men are not of the class represented as ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. True learners of Christ, follow this now, true learners of Christ Jesus learn to a purpose. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Now, what are we learning? Are we learning to a purpose? Becoming more and more Christ-like as a result of this learning?
Amen.
In what? In word and action. What is word and action identifying? My words and my actions are revealing what?
The character.
My character. Okay? Reading that again, becoming more and more Christ-like in character. That's what Jesus is after, isn't He? Isn't that the work that Christ is doing right now?
Amen.
Is to try to put Himself in you, to get you to open that door, surrender your will, and say, not my will, Father, but yours. And allow Jesus to come in and begin that powerful work of destroying self within us. Is this not the work we should be doing right now? Not talking about all the woes of our church. We think, and listen, I'm not trying to be very critical here, but we can talk about, our church is not running short on things to talk about. But there is no church out there that is any better condition. The fact of the matter is that Satan is now distracting God's people, while Sister White says that Jesus is now drawing a covering over His people. And soon that covering will be drawn, and then Satan will laugh because you've been distracted long enough that you didn't work on the character. You were doing other things. You were just learning stuff. Now, let me tell you that in Adventism, let me say at a secular level, knowledge is power. We go to get our doctorates. We go to get our this, that, and the other with all these abbreviations behind our name. Because knowledge empowers us. It makes us feel much more worth. But friends, the only knowledge that's of any value to you and I, if we want to live forever, if we want the life that measures with the life of God, the only knowledge that's going to ever serve us any good is that that is in God's Word that can show you and I where we're falling short so we can fix it before Jesus gets here.
Amen.
And let me be careful here. I'm not talking about righteousness by works. Fix it, meaning I can bring this before Jesus and plead for His power and victory and believe in that power and victory.
Amen.
Before He gets here.
Amen.
Knowledge alone? Is that what we need? There are those that just want the knowledge, friends. They don't want the obedience. They draw near me with lying lips, but their heart is far from me, Jesus says. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. We're going to find that knowledge needs something. Knowledge has to have something with it. 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Notice verse 1 with me. Now, as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up. Now, what I said a moment ago. Excuse me, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet, as he ought to know. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. What does knowledge need coupled with it?
Love, charity.
It has to be love. Right? You have to couple God's love. But God is love. So to pray to be filled with the Holy Spirit is to be praying to be filled with love, to be filled with God.
Amen.
A self-sacrificing love. That's why we're to pray for the Holy Spirit. That's the power. So that's why we'll tell us in other places, love is power. Run that in her writings. Love is power. God's love is power. Know ye not that it is the goodness of God that leadeth thee to repentance? What's the goodness of God? Can you think of a place in history where the goodness of God was iconic? Right here on the cross. It is the goodness of God that leads thee to repentance. This is the greatest expression of God's love, is in giving His only begotten, perfect, darling Son for you and I. So knowledge without the love is of no good, because knowledge and love have to go together. Let's look at chapter 13, verses 2 and 8. Chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, you know this. And though I have the gift of prophecy and what? And understand all mysteries and all knowledge. All right, so you've got all the knowledge now. You've gone to the bank, you've withdrawn everything, you've got all the knowledge. But the Bible's going to tell us that that knowledge alone, without something connected with it, is absolutely worthless. It's worthless to you. And though I have all faith so that I would remove mountains and have not love, charity. It doesn't say I'll be counted as least, as it does in chapter 5 of Matthew. It says I am nothing. Do you understand what the Bible, what Jesus Christ is saying to you and I right now? If you do not have, do not possess, do not manifest, do not exhibit my self-sacrificing love, you are as nothing. Now, does that play out? Yes. Because the wicked are those who are disobedient, who do not love Jesus, and they will be as nothing. They will be as though they never were. We need the love of Christ coupled with the knowledge from His Word. What kind of knowledge? We're going to look more into that. But we need these two combined in our Christian experience. And there are those that are telling people, brother, sister, you just keep reading this message that God is sending through us. You just keep reading this message, and He's going to supernaturally transform your character without your consent.
Nope.
Boy, that would be nice, wouldn't it? We'd just have to study. I wouldn't have to confront myself each day in the selfishness that I see in my heart and the short temper. I don't have to deal with those. God's going to take care of those. They'll just disappear one day like the early morning mist. What a satanic deception. There is a work to be done. The whole Bible expresses a work that we must do. And it's not righteousness by works. Those that say that reveal they don't know the Bible. They don't know Jesus Christ. Because it's very clear in the spirit of prophecy alone that the work lies at our door to do. And that is to bring ourselves before Christ and surrender our will daily, moment by moment. Let me read this to you from Desire of Ages, page 389, paragraph 3. To eat the flesh and drink the blood of Christ is to receive Him as a personal Savior, believing that He forgives our sins and that we are complete in Him. What is it to be complete in Jesus? Character perfection. Does it mean that you won't miss your turn? Does it mean you won't hang a picture crooked? It's talking about offensive in character. It is by beholding, oh, this is going to kill you. It is by beholding His love, by dwelling upon it. What is it? His love. By dwelling upon it, by drinking it in, that we are to become partakers of His nature. You're not leaving this planet unless you possess His character. Unless I possess His character, we're not going anywhere. And His character is love. So if that's a four-letter word for you today, get used to where you're living. You're not going anywhere. Because we need to become more like Jesus. We need to cast off that old man, that selfishness that seems to cling to us like trying to throw a cat out of a moving car. It just clings to us. We want free of it. Only Christ can remove it. And He does it by injecting your heart with His self-sacrificing love, and it just melts off of us. Because that's how it can work. But we've got to believe. What food is to the body, Christ must be to the soul. Now think about when you eat something. Because I want to tell you that there are people that are steadily eating all day long, but their colon is not drawing the nutrition from that food, and it's passing right on through them. They're spiritually starving, though they are gluttons of food, of knowledge. But they're spiritually starving. What food is to the body, Christ must be to the soul. Food cannot benefit us unless we eat it, unless it becomes part of our being. It has to change us. My hair grows longer because I've eaten food and it's fed nutrition and energy to the body and things happen. All right? So Christ is of no value to us if we do not know Him as a personal Savior. Can you tell me what a personal Savior is? What is a personal Savior?
Just one-on-one. Someone you talk to.
Someone you can talk to? How do you relate to these terms? It's important we understand this. How is Jesus to be a personal Savior?
We know Him intimately.
Okay. Now we're getting there. We know Him intimately. How do we know Him intimately?
By eating His flesh.
Let's key on the word Savior. Okay? Personal Savior. What does that mean? How does that work in your life?
Saves us from sin.
Saves us from sin. How about day by day experiences in a Savior rescuing you from bad circumstances? Anybody have any experiences with Jesus saving you throughout the week? Preserving you, helping you to deal with neighbors and circumstances and people we encounter at church and whatever? But better yet, your finances are really tight. Things are really hard for you. Is the personal Savior on vacation now? Or is He still there? Do we believe that? You see, we have to have an experimental religion where we connect with the Word of God and we say, Lord, though You slay me, I will trust in You. I believe in You. I know. And how many of us here now can say this? Don't raise your hands. But how many of us can say in our own hearts, God, You have really thrown me some hard things, but I am going to cling to the hem of Your garment. I'm not going to let You go. You are my Savior. I can't make it without You.
Amen.
That's a personal Savior. Amen. Forgetting everything else, forgetting everyone else in this world, and keeping an eye focused on Jesus, saying, Lord, You're all that I have. What did Peter say when Jesus said, are You going to leave me too? Where can we go? Where else can we go? Jesus is our only hope. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
So friends, we need a personal Savior. Now. Not when the crisis and the storm is about to break upon us, but now.
Amen.
We need to learn what it is to surrender our convictions, our fears, our frustrations to Christ now. And say, Jesus, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. I don't know how I'm going to do this. But I know that you know. I know that you have a way. One time, friends, years ago, I was a single father. I had two sons in academy. I made a transition from working in the trades that summer in August, and I went into business for myself as the Lord opened doors in His providence. And in doing that, what I failed to see later, He would have shown me if I'd been paying attention, it was only my fault, was that I didn't have a clientele base strong enough. And I went into some financial downhill runs, I mean some black holes of experience. I was greatly in the dark, and I felt cut off. I felt the heavens were brass and the earth was iron, and my prayers went nowhere. I wasn't hearing anything from God. I felt like I was in a barren, desolate desert. I went into church one Sabbath. I had $20 in my wallet. I had paid my tithe. At that time, I hadn't studied out offering, and I wasn't familiar with the offering aspect. But as I sat down in that pew, and I looked to my right, and I saw that tray coming, two voices immediately began to speak. One said, "Put your $20 in there." Friends, that's all I had. I didn't have a savings. I'd spent that. I was down to the last. I was wondering what I could buy in the grocery store for $20 for me and my sons to eat off of. I was thinking peanut butter, you know, these kind of survival things. And that plate was coming, and you know it doesn't take long. And the voice says, "Put your 20 in there." The other voice says, "Don't do it. You've already paid your tithe." But before that voice could say too much more, I quickly pulled out that $20. And as I put that 20 in the plate, I said, "God, I know you've got my back. I know it." Before I left church that day, someone came to me and handed me a check for $1,000. Now you tell me that God isn't present. Amen. I'm telling you, friends, we need to understand what it is to have a personal Savior. Personal. You and Him. Not us in Him. You and Him. Our sister here lost her husband recently. She lost her father. And it was just between, even though living in the same home, it was between them and Jesus. They had to deal with it. They still have to deal with it. Amen. We all have to deal with it. Friends, what I'm saying to you is that we are missing out on what knowledge is supposed to do for us. We're to gain knowledge for a purpose, and that's to become more like Jesus.
Amen.
We have to die to self. And if we're not willing to do that, just walk away and quit calling yourself a Christian. Quit pretending. Okay, because you're lukewarm and you're going to lead others into the ditch. We need Jesus Christ as our personal Savior.
Amen.
A theoretical knowledge, she says, will do us no good. Theories don't help us become like Jesus. They just don't. We must feed upon Him, receive Him into the heart so that His life becomes our life. Whose life? Jesus' life. Now I want to tell you something. We're going to come to a quote further into this study. And we're going to clearly identify the knowledge that we must have, that anything other than this, she says, is vanity and nothingness. And you know what? It's not theories. You know what else? It's not parallels. Not that these things don't exist. Not that these things aren't part of God's Word. But when it comes to transformation of character, brothers and sisters, the pen of inspiration is very clear on this matter. She goes on and says, "We must feed upon Him, receive Him into the heart, so that His life becomes our life. His love, His grace must be assimilated. Not His promises." Do we need to cast off the promises? No way. She's not pointing to these things, friends. She's saying His love and His grace need to be assimilated into our characters. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And notice with me verse 18, 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18. The last verse. "But grow in grace." Now we're dealing with knowledge. Okay, these verses are pertaining to knowledge. "But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." So what's the knowledge that we're to gain? The knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
"To Him be glory, now and forever." So it's not just a knowledge, but we need a knowledge of Christ. Why do we need a knowledge of Christ?
He's our Savior.
Here's the clue. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Right? But, let me add one more verse to it. We read it already. John 17:3. For this is life eternal, that they might know thee. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. It's about knowing the Father. Where else can we learn about the Father so thoroughly? Except by the life of Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus came. Listen, we say He is, the Bible says, He is the Word that was made flesh. What that means, and I said this once before, but that means that He wasn't type that suddenly became a personality. He is the very, everything that this Bible would express, would want to express to you and I. Jesus came and lived every element of it. Every bit of what's in here, He lived it. He became the Word in person. I tell you, when you spend time thinking about that, that is powerful. Jesus is who we're to look to. Think about it. Now, we're saying these four books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but come on now. What's written there is the most powerful testimony as to who our Father is. And my eternal life depends upon me knowing the Father. The only way I know I can know the Father is through Jesus Christ. Not just the Word, but His living example. And I'll show you the quotes that tell us exactly that. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Come back into 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Notice verse 1 with me. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Now Jesus is the image of God, and He is the gospel. He's the good news. God is the good news. Amen. And He manifested that by sending His only begotten Son. But read verse 5 with me. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. Now, verse 6. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, He's referring back to creation, when there was nothing but darkness, hath shined in our hearts. Now we're going to know why. To give the light, okay, now we're going to know what the light is that's shining in there. To give the light of the knowledge. So this light is knowledge. What kind of knowledge? Of the glory of God, the character of God. I'm going to show you, I want you to see who God the Father is. This is His glory, and I want to shine that into your darkened hearts. And where do we find this knowledge, this glory?
In the face of Jesus.
In the face of Jesus Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Listen, by beholding we become changed into the same image from glory to glory. It is as we gain the knowledge of the Father, as reflected in the beautiful, glorious face of Jesus Christ, that we are changed into the same image. This is the knowledge that automatically comes with that self-sacrificing love. That's what it is. I want to read to you now from Upward Look, page 78. Now, there are people that scorn the devotionals, but let me tell you that there are devotionals like Christ Triumphant. Just today or yesterday, there's a quote there that is nowhere else in the Spirit of Prophecy, not even in the new releases of all of her letters. Okay? So don't discount. The only concern is that some of them, in assembling them, may give a wrong impression. So follow out your quotes, but I'll tell you that Upward Look and This Day with God are always letters, full letters. They're not compilations. They're letters that Sister White wrote. Anyway, Upward Look, page 78, she says, the Word of God contains our life insurance policy. To eat the flesh and drink the blood of the Son of God means to study the Word and to carry that word into the life in obedience to all its precepts.
Amen. Amen.
Wait a minute. This is where we began, right? The two classes. One is disobedient. The other is obedient. There's two trees. Who do you think is eating from the tree of life? They're going to be the obedient. Okay, that's a no-brainer. They're going to be the obedient. They're the wise. And we're going to show some parallels to these two trees as well later. But she says, okay, so we read that. We're into the life in obedience to all its precepts. It's interesting, friends, when you look at the Bible, there are amazing things you can learn there. But start adding up how many of them are principles that you can apply in your personal experience with Jesus Christ. These are the ones we need to focus on. She says in Desire of Ages, page 161, paragraph 1, from eternal ages it was God's purpose that every created being, from the bright and holy seraph to man, should be a temple for the indwelling of the Creator. Because of sin, humanity ceased to be a temple for God. Darkened and defiled by evil, the heart of man no longer revealed the glory or the character of the Divine One. But by the incarnation of the Son of God, the purpose of heaven is fulfilled. God dwells in humanity, and through saving grace, the heart of man becomes again his temple. Amen. Let me ask you, what is the incarnation of the Son of God? What's another term for that?
Jesus Christ.
The mystery of godliness. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Okay? This is the mystery of godliness in Revelation chapter 10 that was to be accomplished. All right, and what that means is that Christ every day is trying to seat himself upon the throne of your heart, and Satan every day is trying to seat himself upon the throne of your heart. One of those two is going to gain the victory by the close of that day. And each day it's a new battle. Each day it's a new battle. Now, page 3, let's go to the tree of knowledge. There's a lot here, so I do want to move forward. The tree of knowledge. We're going to broach this subject. We have about 8 minutes left thereabouts. And I want to get through here on this page before we go into our next segment. But now we've looked at the tree of life. What have we understood now? We've understood that the knowledge gained at the tree of life comes from eating his flesh and drinking his blood. It's the study of God's word. But it's not just the study of God's word. It's the study of his word to a purpose. In other words, we are to be studying God's word, eating of the tree of life, to the purpose of becoming more like Jesus. Amen. And what is the key thing that we find is connected with the eating of that fruit? We have an obligation to do what?
Assimilate it.
To assimilate it, which is to obey God's word. Okay? To acclimate it. To act on it. Okay? We need knowledge. Eve needed knowledge too, didn't she? She wanted knowledge. Now she walks up to the other tree. She's not over at the tree of life right now. But we're going to take up this story in Genesis chapter 3. If you'll come back to Genesis with me. Let's look at what happened. Oh, if it had just never happened. If it had just never happened. Chapter 3, verse 1. Now we were dealing in prior studies with the theme of the covering of Christ. And we came here as well to Genesis chapter 3, dealing with Eve before this tree, but I didn't come here for that purpose this time. So let's notice something totally different. Chapter 3, verse 1 says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it. What did God mean when he said, ye shall not eat of it? You shall not eat of it. Obey me, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Now listen, we will quickly say in a study of the state of the dead, that here is a lie that is still being perpetuated today, right? We'll say that now. Well, there's another lie that's being told here that I'm going to tell you is also being perpetuated today as well. Because what worked then, he's had all these thousands of years to perfect that lie, saying the same thing in many different ways, but to bring us all into his snare. And the serpent said unto the woman, verse 4, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods. What's the next word?
Knowing.
Knowing. Knowing. You want knowledge, Eve? I got it right here. You'll discover that in the spirit of prophecy, Satan handed Eve the fruit, and she took it. Now, friends, what I want to say to you is we're going to discover Eve wasn't starving. She wasn't just famished for food. Her attraction is that she wanted knowledge. Pardon me. She wanted knowledge. But she wanted knowledge apart from obedience. What was attractive about this fruit wasn't just this exterior. Notice what his words were. For God, verse 5, doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. You're going to have knowledge. You're going to be like God. Let me summarize. Before I do, what is the fruit symbolizing that she's eating? Now, to answer that, let's come over to the tree of life. What did we discover was the eating of the fruit of the tree of life?
Character of God.
What were we eating?
The Word of God.
The Word of God. Oh, so at the tree of death, the fruit that we're eating, it's not the Word of God. What is it? It's the Word of man. It's the teachings of men. It's the lies of Satan, okay, that only lead to death. So here she is. He's giving her the Word of man. You'll be as God. You're going to be like God. You'll have knowledge. So here's the summary. You just gain knowledge. Just keep getting knowledge. Just keep getting it. And you're going to be like God. You're going to have a character like God. You're going to be like God. Just keep, here's knowledge. Just eat of this fruit, you'll gain knowledge, you'll be like God. Do you see any room in there for obedience in the process of becoming like God? Okay, let's come back over to the tree of life. They're eating of the fruit. They're eating of the fruit. And by eating of that fruit, they're also being obedient. The love of Christ is connected with it. It's not the teachings of men they're eating. They're eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Jesus Christ. And as they're doing it, those that are eating of the tree of life, truly, they are drinking in, as we read, the love and the grace of Christ. They are learning to a purpose. Their motivation is different than it was for Eve. Eve's motivation was to become like God without having to do all of these things, without having to fight the fight against self. This was very attractive to Eve. Be like God. Just learn. Are there those out there today that are teaching? You just learn this message. Just learn this message. Don't focus on it. You just learn this message and your character, you're going to have it come into place down the line. God will supernaturally transform your character. That's what Eve is doing. Let me read to you here from the story of redemption, beginning in page 32. You have the quotes before you. This passage, I want us to read and really understand this, and then we'll conclude after this passage before we move on. Satan entered into the serpent and took his position in the tree of knowledge and commenced leisurely eating of the fruit. Eve, unconsciously at first, separated from her husband in her employment. Now watch this. It was unconsciously at first. It was an accident. When she became aware of the fact, what fact? That she was apart from her husband, she felt that there might be danger, but again she thought herself secure, even if she did not remain close by the side of her husband. She had wisdom and strength to know if evil came and to meet it. This the angels had cautioned her not to do. Today, let me put it in our practical layman's terms. Today, there are those among us, this isn't about male or female, there are those among us that feel that we can go and stand before Satan And listen to the words that in the day that you eat thereof, you will be as gods, knowing good and evil. And we think we can pick and choose what fruit from that tree we're going to eat and we'll be okay. But I would caution anyone, if that's the message, you need to flee from the presence of the enemy of souls. You and I, we need to be on guard. We need to guard ourselves against the thinking that we can learn our way into heaven. Now, I'm sure none of us in here have that struggle, but there are many that do. There are many that are learning because they want knowledge, thinking that God is going to love them because they know so much about Him. For this is eternal life, Lord, that they might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ. I know, I've read the Bible from front to back. I know you. But we'll discover more about no here in a little bit. But the point being here is that she had wisdom and strength to know if evil came and to meet it. And let none of us ever believe that we have the ability, because why? We don't wage war against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and wickedness in high places. If I said that correctly. Satan would convey the idea that by eating of the forbidden tree, they would receive a new and more noble kind of knowledge than they had hitherto attained. You see, here at the end of the world, do you think the enemy is using that same tactic that he used in the garden? You know that he is. He's telling people today, if you just learn, I've got something to show you that is awesome. Unbelievable parallels, unbelievable light. And I want to show it to you. And they say to themselves, they would receive a new and more noble kind of knowledge than they'd hitherto attained. That's what they're hoping for. That's what Eve hoped for. Watch. This has been his special work with great success ever since his fall. To lead men to pry into the secrets of the Almighty and not be satisfied with what God has revealed. And not carefully to what? To obey that which he has commanded. All right, listen. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And what was the other one? Love your neighbor as yourself. You'll discover in a very shallow study in the spirit of prophecy that you cannot truly love Jesus unless you have a true, genuine love for the souls for whom he died. So if I see an individual that's treating people like trash, selectively making friends, not exhibiting any type of Christian graces towards humanity, then I can't for one minute believe that the light they have is what I need to be drinking.
Amen.
Obedience, friends, is where we're headed. Eve wanted knowledge apart from obedience. It goes on and says, he would lead them to disobey God's commands and then make them believe that they are entering a wonderful field of knowledge. And he does it. Don't say to yourself, that's ridiculous. What moron would actually do that? It happens every day. There are people that think that what they are learning is some new and incredible stuff that's going to mean their salvation. She says, this is purely supposition and a miserable deception. They fail to understand what God has revealed and disregard his explicit commandments and aspire after wisdom, independent of God, and seek to understand that which he has been pleased to withhold from mortals. They are elated with their ideas of progression and charmed with their own vain philosophy, but grope in midnight darkness relative to true knowledge. Oh, they're gaining the knowledge, but it's not true knowledge, and it leaves them in darkness. They are ever learning, here they are, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Well, they're getting a knowledge, but it's not the knowledge of the truth. We'll discover what that is later on. Eve had thought herself capable of deciding between right and wrong. Maybe you think that way today. Maybe you think you can pick and choose like a buffet, this presenter or that presenter, this is okay and that's okay. Friends, we have to be very careful where we're pulling up a chair. The flattering hope of entering a higher state of knowledge had led her, Eve, to think that the serpent was her especial friend, possessing a great interest in her welfare. Had she sought her husband and they had related to their maker the words of the serpent, they would have been delivered at once from his artful temptation. You know what that's saying? You need to go and flee to, not your husband, but to the Word of God. Thus saith the Lord, to confirm what you're being taught.
Amen.
Friends, I want to, in this first part, in summary, we're looking at two classes in this world. There's only ever two classes. One class is eating at the tree of life. They're gaining a knowledge, but that knowledge is combined with love and a purpose in their heart to become like Christ. This knowledge is learned, and in it, in the learning of it, they are becoming obedient to it. These are growing up into the full stature of the men and women in Christ Jesus. There's another class that are eating from the tree of knowledge, the tree of death. They're eating this knowledge, they're drinking this knowledge in with the thought and hope that they will become like God, that they will be acceptable to God. And yet they do not want to be obedient. They do not want the obedience that comes with it, the self-sacrifice that we must make in order to overcome in our lives. And this is where we will conclude part one. If you'll join me as far as you're able, let us pray. Our most holy Father in heaven, glory and honor and praise be to thy holy name. Father, let us not, those within the sound of my voice, Father, let us never attempt to gain knowledge apart from obedience. Father, we need your self-sacrificing love. We need that love within us, Father, so that it is not said of us that we are as nothing. And I pray, Lord Jesus, today that your Holy Spirit would speak to us so clearly, so distinctly. May we recognize within ourselves where we are falling short. May we come up to the standards, Father, of your word, of your law. We pray for great wisdom. We pray for your peace, your grace, and we pray, Father, for your abiding presence that we might overcome and stand upon that sea of glass at last. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers, and we ask that you would please continue and attend our meetings, for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.